developed in our work an acronym to guide parents. It's the ideal response for discipline. I stands for immediate. D stands for direct. E.
how does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking? We'll just talk.
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking? We'll just talk.
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
And it's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
It's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
It's not just anger. What triggers a teenager to regress to thumb sucking?
How does a little kid even have this much in him and this much anger?
According to NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, 43.8 million adults in the U.S. experience mental illness in a given year. That means that within our church alone, one in every five adults is experiencing a mental illness. However, despite the large number of individuals that have a mental illness, many live life without support due to increased stigma surrounding mental illness. Stigma can be categorized into two types: social stigma, which is the reaction that others have towards people with mental illness, and self-stigma, which is the prejudice which people with mental illness turn against themselves. Stigma hurts. Stigma hurts our church, our community, our friends, family, and ourselves. We know that stigma negatively impacts daily life for a person living with mental illness. Studies reveal that 81% of people with a mental illness experience high levels of discrimination from others, and further, 69% would rather keep their illness a secret to avoid prejudice. These statistics are not just numbers. They are individuals seeking acceptance and support during crisis. We would like to assume that the church is set apart from these numbers, that we, as a congregation, are helping the problem. But let me ask you, when was the last time you made a prayer request for someone with a mental illness? Or have a church member visit someone with a severe mental illness in the hospital? Or provide food, respite, and care for family members dealing with a loved one suffering from mental illness? Instead of turning towards those hurting, we often turn away because of fear, prejudice, and discrimination. We value comfortability rather than engaging in open conversations about mental health issues. I'm not sharing this information to make you feel guilty, but rather to draw attention towards a population within our church that desperately needs a voice and support. We as a church can engage on a deeper level to provide love and acceptance to those that are often cast aside in our culture. Jesus did this with many throughout his life. We have a model through his redemptive work to follow. I'm going to share five things that you can do to help reduce the stigma of mental illness in our church. Number one, you can start talking openly about mental health with others. Two, you can educate yourself and others about mental health. It's still okay to throw out words like crazy, psycho, and lunatic, etc. Number three, you can encourage equality in how people perceive physical illness and mental illness. Number four, show empathy and compassion for those living with a health condition. Number five, pray and search your soul and pray for God to reveal any stigmatizing thoughts or beliefs that you have going on in your soul as well. Reducing stigma around mental illness is challenging, but we as a church are committed to sharing the love of Jesus wherever we are. It begins by seeking God's love and searching our heart to engage in the way He desires for us as a church and believers to live out. According to NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, 43.8 million adults in the U.S. experience mental illness in a given year. That means that within our church alone, one in every five adults is experiencing a mental illness. However, despite the large number of individuals that have a mental illness, many live life without support due to increased stigma surrounding mental illness. Stigma can be categorized into two types: social stigma, which is the reaction that others have towards people with mental illness, and self-stigma, which is the prejudice which people with mental illness turn against themselves. Stigma hurts. Stigma hurts our church, our community, our friends, family, and ourselves. We know that stigma negatively impacts daily life for a person living with mental illness. Studies reveal that 81% of people with a mental illness experience high levels of discrimination from others, and further, 69% would rather keep their illness a secret to avoid prejudice. These statistics are not just numbers. They are individuals seeking acceptance and support during crisis. We would like to assume that the church is set apart from these numbers, that we, as a congregation, are helping the problem. But let me ask you, when was the last time you made a prayer request for someone with a mental illness? Or have a church member visit someone with a severe mental illness in the hospital? Or provide food, respite, and care for family members dealing with a loved one suffering from mental illness? Instead of turning towards those hurting, we often turn away because of fear, prejudice, and discrimination. We value comfortability rather than engaging in open conversations about mental health issues. I'm not sharing this information to make you feel guilty, but rather to draw attention towards a population within our church that desperately needs a voice and support. We as a church can engage on a deeper level to provide love and acceptance to those that are often cast aside in our culture. Jesus did this with many throughout his life. We have a model through his redemptive work to follow. I'm going to share 5 with mental illness in a given year. That means that within our church alone, 1 in every 5 adults is experiencing a mental illness. However, despite the large number of individuals that have a mental illness, many live life without support due to increased stigma surrounding mental illness. Stigma can be categorized into 2 types. Social stigma, which is the reaction that others have towards people with mental illness, and self-stigma, which is the prejudice which people with mental illness turn against themselves. Stigma hurts. Stigma hurts our church, our community, our friends, family, and ourselves. We know that stigma negatively impacts daily life for a person living with mental illness. Studies reveal that 81% of people with a mental illness experience high levels of discrimination from others, and further, 69% would rather keep their illness a secret to avoid prejudice. These statistics are not just numbers. They are individuals seeking acceptance and support during crisis. We would like to assume that the church is set apart from these numbers, that we, as a congregation, are helping the problem. But let me ask you, when was the last time you made a prayer request for someone with a mental illness? Or have a church member visit someone with a severe mental illness in the hospital? Or provide food, respite, and care for family members dealing with a loved one suffering from mental illness? Instead of turning towards those hurting, we often turn away because of fear, prejudice, and discrimination. We value comfortability rather than engaging in open conversations about mental health issues. I'm not sharing this information to make you feel guilty, but rather to draw attention towards a population within our church that desperately needs a voice and support. We as a church can engage on a deeper level to provide love and acceptance to those that are often cast aside in our culture. Jesus did this with many throughout his life. We have a model through his redemptive work to follow. I'm going to share 5 things that you can do to help reduce the stigma of mental illness in our church. Number 1, you can start talking openly about mental health with others. 2, you can educate yourself and others about mental health. It's still okay to throw out words like crazy, psycho, lunatic, etc. Number 3, you can encourage equality in how people perceive physical illness and mental illness. Number 4, show empathy and compassion. The National Alliance on Mental Illness, 43.8 million adults in the U.S. experience mental illness in a given year. That means that within our